Welcome to the MVB Podcast, the most valuable banter on the internet, where we discuss video games, tabletops, pen and paper RPGs, and also other sources of entertainment media. We discuss their design, philosophies, and the controversies that surround them. Or we just comment on about anything, really. Please welcome your hosts, Beard and Matt, because it starts in 3, 2, 1.
Welcome, everybody, to another episode of the MVB Podcast, the show where we create an echo chamber where you can feel like your opinions are validated. I'm your host, Beard, joined always by Matt.
Hey.
How's it going, bud?
Hello. Today, Beard, I will attempt to... I'm going full French. I will channel my Frenchness. I am drinking wine, and I...
That's pretty French.
That's very French.
Are you eating a croissant and wearing a beret?
No, and no cheese.
You fit your country.
But you know what they say?
Are you 13? You can be French Canadian, and then you just have to hate immigrants, which you do already. you're pretty cool, Becker.
There you go. I'm doing it with baby steps, as they say, pied de bébé in French. It's not really an expression. I just translated it, but.
okay.
Anyways, we got a great show planned. Which has nothing to do with France. So I guess we'll just go on ahead. Gaming news. Lots of games got updated. We're going to talk about, of course, Dead by Daylight's getting a new killer. Dota 2 had a massive update that changed a few mechanics when it comes to the game. Binding of Isaac, Afterbirth Plus, will come January. And we have also clues for what will be coming for... Overwatch. They will have, of course, a holiday event, and then there's a bunch of other gaming news. Castlevania Fan Remake hit with a cease and desist by Konami. Now, it's become obvious when Nintendo does it, but nobody's really surprised that Konami would do it, because they're like, wait, we're not getting any money from this. Kill, kill, kill.
And not even that. I mean, they've been building up their reputation as assholes for a little while now. Like, why not continue the trend?
Of course. Pokemon Go is going to get a bunch of very interesting updates. Then we will have... there's actually something interesting that is coming from China, one of the best countries in the world, am I right? And mm-hmm. They will have... I guess it's sort of also related to Overwatch, but I mean, any game where loot boxes are involved, they will try to force... games to disclose their odds, at least in China, which is interesting. I'm super hyped about it. We're going to talk about it when that comes. Then we're going to have some news about Super Mario Run, which if you thought this was a disaster already, well, another detail got revealed, which will pretty much ensure that it will destroy itself. And I guess the last thing in gaming news is apparently Crytek employees say that they're not being paid again. Oh, good. Don't do this. Then, before we jump into the cringe corner, we had a comment from Nayambe, who asked Beard a little bit, because Beard told this story where he wrote this... Oh, and that's Beard disconnecting. Probably too embarrassed. No, I'm kidding. It's just internet problems we've been having. But he's been talking about how he wrote this bullshit essay about why in Spider-Man 3, Mary Jane is the real villain, and I thought maybe you could talk about it a little bit on the actual show if we have time, because that's kind of funny. Then, Cringe Corner. So, we've talked, of course, a lot about Gamergate when it happened, we did talk about how there was an FBI investigation going on looking into Gamergate, and, oh, are they really this evil terrorist group? Well, finally, the information has been released and has been posted online. A few people have been going over it, and we'll tell you, did they find anything or did they not? If you've been following Gamergate, you might have a clue about if they did, but let's not spoil it. Then, so they're making a movie, Beard.
About Dead Island, I know.
No, it's about esports. It will be starring Will Ferrell as a pro gamer.
What the fuck?
It's going to be great. It's going to be great. Then we're going to look at, of course, Times Magazine released their, like, Person of the Year, like, big edition thing. And they have a top 100 fictional characters. And we're going to look over a little bit of those. Then we're going to go back on the new Final Fantasy game, because there's been new details that have been popping out. Like, for example, when Jonathan McIntosh was calling it sexist and toxic masculinity, well, apparently some people just posted this argument to him and replied, so that's going to be interesting to see. Then
I'm sure he considered their arguments and was like, wow, in that light, I changed my opinion.
Of course.
You know, because Jonathan McIntosh is such a level-headed individual who is quick to change his opinion when presented with evidence.
Yeah, and of course there's a few things I'm not mentioning, but we're going we're gonna have, I mean, it's gonna be a review. We're not gonna read all of it, but it is about Mario and Sonic at the Sochi Olympics, and apparently this. Well, you'll see. They'll put politics into this article into the probably funniest way possible, and then finally we have an article that is titled "Anime's Fan Service Can Be a Minefield." It's true. It can be. And be very dangerous.
Right. Are we going to be talking about another anime that it's like, I can't believe this hentai exploits women?
Well,
I really don't like how furries like to watch animals fucking. Like, well, I don't know what to tell you.
Yeah, I know. All right, let's just jump in on to the gaming news. So first up, I guess I'll have to screen share with Beard again. We're going to do this really quick. So Dota has released their 7.00 update, The New Journey. Now, of course, knowing that not everybody that's watching plays Dota, I'm going to go over it really, really quickly. But it's fairly major. Of course, it adds a new hero called the Monkey King, which has...
Wait. So when you said before this show, Dota, like, they finally added their own original hero, what you meant to say was they have finally just... taken a fictional character and put it into Dota.
Well, I mean...
you understand Monkey King is not an original character.
No, I do know that, but... Right.
Okay.
To be completely fair...
It took Dota 5 years to steal someone's idea. Okay,
well,
got it.
No, just listen. There was this item in Dota that was there
called
for
the
like, yes, yeah. For a billion years. So finally, I guess he's just being like, hey, you guys stole my bar. Can I have it back? But yeah, he's going to be coming in and he has very interesting abilities. I'm not going to go over all of them, but one is very interesting and shows that with new heroes, they're really going to go try to veer away from the boring design of heroes. So the Monkey King, for example, has this ability that allows him to jump from treetop to treetop, and then he can just slam from that tree into like a big area. So that's one of the ability that's very interesting and unique, using trees again in interesting ways. New HUD, you're going to be able to see more of the map, a new way to just pre-games. So the new pre-game thing is basically they will try to help players and teams focus on strategy and planning, just so it's less of a clusterfuck, which for Dota is a little bit interesting. So that's definitely a cool thing. A new gameplay, I guess, is the only thing really that I'm going to jump into. Oh boy,
loading Ursa fighting the. Whatever is sure taking a long time.
Yeah, you know, they switch Roshan's spot, but you know, nobody really cares. So they added this.
Moving them around.
Yeah, they added this talent 3 thing instead of just bonus stats, which will allow you to customize your heroes in interesting ways. So we'll just look at Wraith King so that people understand what goes on. So at level 10, you can pick between, do I want 15 more damage? Do I want 8 intelligence because I want to be able to cast my spells more? Or do I just want to speed up my farming? And at level 25, you can pick between 20% more vampiric or a lifesteal to really help your team, or if really there's an anti-mage that is wrecking your face, you can have your reincarnation not cost any mana, so you can actually have your second life instead of just dying. So I do like it a lot because instead of just stats, it allows you to adapt your hero to what you need at that time. And I think it makes everybody a bit more versatile. I do hear that some of the talent trees are more interesting and crazy than others. But, I mean, so I guess that's a criticism. But some are very interesting. Like for Jakiro at level 10, you can pick, do you want 15% more XP gain? Because that's a problem that Jakiro has. They're often underleveled. But now, if you want, you can either pick that or your spells do a little bit more damage. So, you know, it's cool stuff. It's really, I really like what they've done with this Dota update. It probably will improve the game, and it probably also will cause me to maybe give it a second look, maybe go back. Next up.
Yeah, it's only your favorite game.
Oh, shut up. It's a great game.
You haven't said that on the show. Yeah.
It definitely is. So, of course, Dead by Daylight also released their Chapter 3 DLC, which is called Of Flesh and Mud, which introduces a new killer called the Hag. Her ability is she puts sigils, which acts as traps on the ground, and when a survivor gets close, an illusion double of herself will pop out, at which point the Hag can choose to enter it and take the place of the illusion or not, which then we'll have the survivors wonder, is that the real witch, or is she creeping up behind me? So that, and then, of course, her map is a backwater swamp, which is always cool. And I guess they have a new survivor called Ace, which has passive abilities based on luck. So, yeah, no, that's an interesting new killer. Me and Beard talked about it.
So yeah, I did have the opportunity to play against the Hag. I haven't played as her yet. But another thing worth mentioning is...
Uh-oh, that's Beard disconnecting just as I was taking a sip of my French wine. So, yeah, I guess one thing that I really liked, and I don't know exactly how it will apply, but the fact that it's another killer that uses a trap is very interesting, because some survivors already have passives that work exclusively on traps, and so far there was only the Trapper, which had traps, so at least it's like two killers that will have traps, so hopefully it will help balance this whole thing a little bit. Oh, and here's Beard. Welcome back.
Gonna be one of those days. Anyways, like I was saying, she is like one of the smallest of the killers, even compared to the nurse, who's like pretty slender. You can still see her from far away. I only played one match against the witch, but she's all like gnarled over. So she is really difficult to see from far away, which is interesting, like even that in and of itself. I just enjoyed sort of like getting into the game again. I didn't get the chance to play as her. We were sort of talking about like how, you know, whether or not she might be like OP or like how the power is used. I don't think we should waste time talking about it here, if only because I haven't had the chance to actually like play as her yet and sort of get a feel for what she can do.
Yep. All right, so next up, let's talk about Beard's favorite game ever. That is not Undertale.
Then it's not. Binding Isaac. I thought this was supposed to come out Halloween. I was really missing this.
Yeah, I guess that's true.
They didn't want to do it, I guess. You know.
So this is an article by Alex Santamaria on the Binding of Isaac Afterbirth Plus will come out in January. And here's how it goes. It's been about a year since The Binding of Isaac Afterbirth made its debut and greatly expanded on the item and enemy variety of the base rebirth experience. At the time, many thought that this was the last hurrah for Isaac and that the community would carry on the torch from there. Those people were half right, as the release of Afterbirth Plus is coming January on PC and it will make that process a lot easier. Afterbirth Plus features a lot of the things you'd expect from an Isaac expansion at this point. It extends the game with an additional chapter and a new final boss. Yes! That's really good.
Sweet.
As well as a new character to conquer them with. Again, sweet. It has over 60 new items. Again, yes. Several new transformations, 100 of new room layouts. Thank God, new foes, new variants of existing foes, new tweaks to green mode, and much more. That's all to be expected from one of the most complex roguelites out on the market. What is new and potentially very exciting is mod tools. Afterbirds Plus will come with a full modding suite that will allow players to take advantage of the community's existing passion for grafting new content onto the Binding of Isaac. Perhaps even more excitingly, Afterbirth Plus will also allow the game's developers to pick the best of the best from the modding community and place it into the game proper. So, yeah, that's pretty cool.
So you know, taking notes from Bethesda.
Yes, yeah, basically.
I mean this in the best possible way.
Yeah, because Edmund McMillan did finish his game, and like twice over, at least, you know? So it's not like he's just asking people to finish the game. It's just he basically is granting his game immortality. This is the game's phylactery. There you go. D&D jokes up in there. where was I? That means that Isaac will only be getting bigger in 2017 with constant updates similar in scope to those seen in Halo 5 and the Salad Days of Team Fortress 2. You can grab the latest Isaac expansion starting on January 3rd for $10 redos on Steam. Although owners of the original Afterbirth, there will be a temporary launch discount, which will bring the price of the game down to $6.66. Which I'm sure is not just it's a perfect price. The update.
And, you know, if we learned anything from the last update, people will have to keep an eye out for ARG. Like, I'm sure that there's going to be some sort of, like, weird, you know, there's actually, like, an even bigger update along with it that we'll have to uncover, but I will leave that to nerds who have more time than myself.
Yeah, I mean, that would be interesting, and I guess I'll just say that the last thing that the article mentions is console peasants will have to wait a little bit longer to get it. All right, that's enough. Next up, news from Overwatch. This is the update episode of the MVB podcast. So this is by Kyle Downey, again on TechRaptor, and I'm not going to read the whole thing, but they already discovered a few things that will be coming in the game, so people who have the visual feed will be able to recognize here the Torbjorn hero, which is basically a dwarf. Well, now he looks like Santa Claus. Instead of his hook, he has a candy cane hook for some reason, which is hilarious. It seems to be based kind of like on his pirate form, which is a bit strange. So he's like a Santa Claus pirate thing. Okay, interesting. And they have also, of course, had they have a list of the characters that have the new highlight intro skins and all that kind of stuff. I'm not initially going to name them here because it's not that interesting. But and here's a bunch of also, I guess, yeah, just a list of heroes that might not get the coolest items, but just like secondary items. So there you go. Very excited about all that cool stuff that's coming. All right, let's talk about something a little bit more substantial before going into just more and more updates.
Bullshit.
Please, Beard.
More updates. I thought we were already at the part where we talked about Trash Fire.
Trash Fire?
Oh, your love interest. Look, everyone, it's Matt's waifu.
Oh, they can't see it, but here it is.
It's Dante.
Yeah, Dante.
Devil May Cry.
Dante, my girlfriend. This is an article by Niche Gamer by Matthew Sigler, and it is titled Marvel vs. Capcom Infinite is the start of Capcom bringing back dormant IPs. The article goes like this. According to the downloadable content kings themselves, Capcom, we will soon see more dormant IPs coming back into the limelight. In a press release about Marvel vs. Capcom Infinite, Capcom said, in addition to regular major title release each fiscal year, Capcom is currently focused on reviving series that have not had new entries recently or otherwise dormant IPs, beginning with Marvel vs. Capcom Infinite. So I guess that's the first game of the game that it will try to bring back. A return for the series following a five-year hiatus. Capcom looks to enhance its corporate value by blah, 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 blah. So yeah, so can we see maybe a new Mega Man? Can we see maybe a new Devil May Cry? Maybe Ghouls and Ghosts or Ghouls and Goblins or whatever it's called. I don't know. Anything new that Capcom could just make, I would be extremely excited. Hey, maybe a new Mega Man Battle Network. Maybe we can dream, folks. We can just dream. It's the end of 2016. We can wish for anything. But yeah, I guess.
Or they're just gonna bring back, you know, their usual shit and just forget this press release entirely.
I mean, I hope not, but...
Most likely. It's the corporate machine just holds up a megaphone and is like, I'm going to do everything you want, and then it just goes back inside. Great. Everybody cheers, and then it fucks off.
Yeah, it would be a bit disappointing, but I guess just a quick news thing that I'm going to bring here. Right now on Steam Greenlight, there is a remaster of a 3 horror game called Spooky's Jump Scare Mansion. And this one is called the HD Renovation. It is basically just the same game, but with higher resolution, better graphics.
You did a Let's Play of this, right?
Yeah, I did the first quarter. I never did finish it, but I think not the last Halloween, but the one before, I did, on this very channel, do a little stream of this game, which is very interesting and had lots of promise. Maybe I'll finish it. Who knows? But if you liked it, for example, you could maybe take some time to thumbs this thing up. I don't know exactly if this one is supposed to be free, too, but I think it will.
I assume so.
So I guess they're explaining why it's a new game. I think they're using a new engine and all that kind of stuff. Oh, and apparently they're adding VR support. I don't know if it's free or not, but anyways, it was definitely a very fun, interesting game that it blended horror and humor in various interesting ways. Because, of course, there's always a setup, and then there's like a punchline, which is either a laugh or a scare. And sometimes you don't know if the game will hit you with a scare or a laugh, so you're like, you're really not sure how to react. Like an example is like at the beginning of the game, some things will pop up at you, like jump scares, but they're just like cute little ghosties that aren't really scary. They're just cute pictures. So that's a game that I enjoyed. All right. Next up, speaking of creepy castles / houses, I guess.
What?
creepy residences. We're going to talk about. You're cutting out, Beard, sorry. This is again from TechRaptor by Chris Henderson. Castlevania fan remake hit with a cease and desist by Konami, and it is a remake of the original game that was made in Unreal. And you can, I guess, just take a look at what it looks like. You can see mostly like the first level, and the mechanics are working exactly like they do in the original game. I assume it's not entirely finished because you can see logos here on screen like the two Roman numerical boost upgrade that looks really high quality, but like the HP and the cross is just pixels. Although, as you can see, the levels are completely, I guess, in 2.5D. The 3D graphics, but yeah, the game is 2.5D.
Right.
So, and for what it is, it really looks well. For a professional game, it would look crazy and polished, but I assume that even this is not quite finished, and it is very much a shame that... See, instead of doing a cease and desist, like, your fans have been fucking barking for anything Castlevania. You could have been like... Like, would it be so hard to be like, hey, we'll sell it, we'll allow you to work on it, like, I mean, those people, you can just do a deal with them or something, just instead of just, again, shitting on it. It's definitely...
There's got to be room here. Like, there's got to be room for either, like, legislation or something. Because, I mean, I sincerely doubt that any of these fans have aspirations. And I understand if they don't do anything, then people will start selling it for money. And, like, I can understand why that's not cool. But I don't understand why, like... the same thing that we have on YouTube where people can put up like, you know, TV shows almost in their entirety, but just comment over it like we did with Twilight Zone just say that it's protected under, you know, like freedom to create fan things. Right. Like, I don't understand why we don't have protection for this already, because there's clearly a lot of like passion that goes into it. And, you know, though there is the risk that people could charge money for it if they get out in front of it. But I mean, who the fuck am I talking about? I'm talking about corporations who will never, ever, ever take the initiative on anything.
Although there could be a glimmer of hope, I guess. Well, just read this part of the article. It says, alas, it seems that Konami would rather not have Deja Wolf, which is the one who's making this mod, continue the remake, and has sent him a formal cease and desist letter asking Deja Wolf to immediately stop developing the remake. In an update on the project's official website, Deja Wolf informs his followers about the cease and desist, which doesn't seem to come as a surprise to the creator. What is a surprise, however, is that Konami has allowed Deja Wolf to continue hosting all of the currently released content on his website. So I guess if you want to download it, do it now. I can't because I'm hosting a podcast, but hopefully it's still up by the end. It also seems that Deja Wolf is trying to work with Konami to see if they can officially license the IP. Huh. And if they do, which is, I guess this is one of the articles I haven't read before, but great idea. Great idea. Here's just a tweet where he says, I finally got a C&D from Konami. They've allowed me to keep the files up for now, but all development and updates must be ceased. Although there's a small glimmer of hope, Jay from Konami UK will do what he can to see if it's possible to get an official license.
And I sincerely doubt that. That's just me.
I mean,
like, I bet, because, you know, on a phone call or an email or whatever, like, I could understand Deja Wolf trying to be like as sympathetic as possible, and I totally understand. Like, it's really easy for somebody to just be like, yeah, no, we're definitely gonna work with you, we're gonna do, we already saw this with Blizzard, right, with their fucking World of Warcraft legacy servers. They're just like, yeah definitely, I'll meet you halfway, and then they don't, right? Like, to me, it would be very un-Konami for them to assist with something like this.
That is
like
true.
I deeply, deeply doubt that they have any plans to do anything. Like, the, I'm sure that there's some sort of like weird legality, or even just Konami's own sort of like fucking ignorance of anything, that they're like, yeah, whatever, you can keep it up there, I don't care, just stop working on what you're working on, and like, yeah, sure, we'll help you.
But
they're not fuck all.
Yeah, what I would say, and that's your only chance really, is you should really push the angle of like trying to like think of all the money you'll make Konami, so much money, and maybe then they'll listen. But otherwise, yeah, it's
because definitely like firing the person who made the game that made you the most money on your team sounds like they like money. They're just too stupid to
That's true.
My suggestion to Deja Wolf would be like, do like the Mighty Number 9 thing. I know that that's a bad example, but like, just turn it into Passylvania and turn it into like, you know, Bymond Selmont in you know, fighting Daunt Cacula.
This is amazing.
Right? Good. And nobody can cease and desist you. Just like change the level design a little
gonna
bit.
It's definitely
not Castlevania, wink, no. Wink.
It's Vastalkania. There you go.
Yeah, but like Niobe says, it might impact pachinko sales. Yeah, they don't give two shits.
Maybe you could, if this game is successful, maybe you can make a pachinko machine out of it.
Oh, don't worry. I'm sure they already have a fucking Castlevania pachinko. They don't need a successful game distracting people from their shitty gambling machines.
Some people say that the only reason why Konami might still make some games of their IPs is to try to give them a little bit of value and then sell them all, which I hope it's what they do, because they shouldn't have them.
I don't know, man. Like, corporations are never going to do what to us seems like reasonable, right? Like, you think, like, you know, and look, I'm not about to pretend that I have a strong understanding of like how the corporation works, but to me, just on like basic idea, because here's how it works. It's like they could sell the IP and make, you know, a lot of money. They could make a lot of money right now, or they could hold on to the IP and do nothing, but maybe they will change their mind in the future. And that's how most corporations think. I'm just going to sit here and do nothing, but as long as I have the IP, that means I can just like keep taking money from the, you know, from all previous iterations, and I don't have to put any effort in. So I'm just gonna sit here like a blob on top of all of this fucking, you know, like that. That's just how they work. That's how all corporations work. It's not just video games. They don't fucking do anything. They just sit there absorbing people's ideas.
I'm sitting here all naive and hopeful, and Beer's just like, "No, Matt, you don't understand.
That's not how it works.
There is no hope. There is only death and despair." I'm like, okay.
No, really, like, to me, I think that, and I know it won't happen.
I mean,
like,
it's Konami.
Because we're starting to get there. Like, I know, but I'm starting to think that corporations are really starting to, and maybe it's just because of the economy, and, like, maybe it's because video games are getting so big. I can remember I predicted that games were going to crash, like, fucking when we started this show, like, 3 years ago or something. And I don't know if that's going to happen, but to me, it's like, it seems like if corporations do real big misstep, they can, like, really fuck themselves. And to me, you know, hopefully when, like, the next generation gets older, they can get out in front of this shit and be like, okay, let's put legislation in place that protects people who do fan games. Like, as long as you're not selling it for any money, you can do whatever you want, like Bethesda style. Like, you want to mod shit, fine, go right ahead, but you're protected. Don't sell it for any money, right?
Yeah, I mean, there definitely should be a fan game addition to the law. Because to try to play that maybe devil's advocate a little bit, I do understand if companies want to protect their IPs to make sure that the game is not, like, maybe just the name of the game is not getting damaged. But most of the times when you see these fan games, it's really just a labor of love, and I don't see any reason why they shouldn't be released.
I don't see why it would be tarnished through fan games, you know what I mean? Like, to me, we've never seen, like, look at what they're willing to do to Mario. Like, let's put him on a mobile side-running bullshit game. You think that Nintendo thinks, like, there can be too much Mario in two shit? They made him a doctor. They put him in fucking tennis. They don't give a shit. It's just the more that's out there, right? Like,
those fucking monsters. They made him a doctor. He had to go through all these years of medical school. And these years, his passion was fucking unplugging pipes.
Hey, Tetris is popular. What can we do? A Tetris clone with Mario. Great. Like, and
it's
they
not
do
a
it
Tetris clone, though. It doesn't have the same gameplay.
Okay, Matt. All right. Like,
it's not the fucking same.
Blocks fall from the ceiling. I know it's not exactly the same, but it's like saying Candy Crush and the fucking, you know, Bejeweled are not the same.
No, they are, because it's about matching
differences.
It's matching three
Whatever.
Things.
I don't want to debate fucking Dr. Mario.
You have
Tetris
to match the colors. It's not about ending lines.
I'm very confident that the success of Tetris is what inspired Dr. Mario. But anyways, it doesn't matter. I'm just saying that, like, I think if someone releases a shitty Sonic game and, like, the bar is set so low, I have a hard time. It just a fucking JPEG of Sonic masturbating would be the only thing worse than what fucking Sega can create itself.
I mean, it could
being be prolific. Being prolific, I don't see how that hurts the IP, right?
I think a JPEG of Sonic masturbating is better than Sonic 06 already. So there's that. But Beard's not laughing at my joke. He must be disconnecting. So I guess I'll just move on to the next article, which is on GameSpot by Eddie McCooch. Eddie's titled Pokemon Go's nearby feature expands again. Wait, Pokemon Go's nearby? Okay, whatever. But basically, they're talking about all the new things that will be coming. Which is only the only important bit is the end. In another Pokemon Go news, Niantic has confirmed that more critters are coming to the game. So we will see, and by more critters, of course, they mean the 100 Pokemon of the second generation of Pokemon, so you're gonna have more Pokemon to capture. The I guess Starbucks will now also be Pokestops and Pokemon gyms, because they're having this partnership, so you can I mean, it's not like you weren't already wasting your time with your iPhone at Starbucks, so now there's gonna be like Pokemons and shit. So this is, I assume, what many businesses did just naturally when it came out. Now, except it's going to be like all the Starbucks, which I guess is smart for Niantic because they're definitely going to make lots of money from this. And I think another interesting feature is that some of what they will add is, I believe, shiny Pokemon will appear.
Sorry, I was so pissed about the Dr. Mario comment. I had to go cool down.
Yeah, we're talking about Pokemon Go, which will add the second generation of Pokemon soon. And shiny Pokemon. Yay.
Go figure.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. And I think that's pretty much it. And yeah, I've been playing in the past few months from time to time, and it's really easier now to catch Pokemon. They really pop up more, especially around Pokestops, so it's less of a pain, at least even for me. So,
right, yeah. Oh, I'm surprised. I mean, with the shaky release, like, it's interesting to see, but I mean, you know, with something so successful like this, I guess it's good they fixed it. I was going to say, like, they had to fix it, but that's not true. I mean, Minecraft was under development for years, and nobody, you know, they still made their money.
The best way to fix Minecraft right now is for me to go on a vacation. Hashtag Notch. But I mean, hey, it didn't go too bad for him. He's really rich. And he's...
I know, but with that being said, it's like, well, and he's... being rich doesn't necessarily mean that you like did all the right stuff. You know what I mean? Like,
of course it did.
He's like a cool guy, but Minecraft took fucking forever. You know, when he's finally like, yeah, it's released.
The richest people are always the most moral people, Beard, especially rich CEOs.
Yeah.
They're great people. I won't let you shit on them in Trump's America, god damn it.
And he's president. He's the best of us.
Yeah. So moving on, TechRaptor Anson Chan, this is titled China's loot box law may actually help games like Overwatch get more money. Huh, I'm not sure about this, but
yeah. Yeah, and even they speculate on it in the article, so I'm not entirely sure why they... I guess just because people wouldn't have opened the thing if they're like, here's a law that China is going to implement and nowhere else.
Yeah,
but it's interesting. It would be interesting to see if they actually did this. So why don't you... do you want to summarize the article?
Should I read it now? I think basically what they plan...
Yeah, it's sort of like what they do with booster packs with like trading card games. They're actually going to tell you like what is drop rate in with these loot boxes, yeah, so that it's not straight up gambling. Now,
yeah,
in the article, anyways, this is sort of just working from memory, but they speculate that it can kind of go either way, because if you know what the drop rate is, then they can also like artificially manufacture situations where they're like, you know, you can buy the standard loot box, which has like a, and they put the stats out there, like for Overwatch, if there's, you know, 600 outfits or whatever, it's like you have a 0.1% chance to get like one thing that you want. But if you know what the stats are, then they could even release loot boxes, kind of like what Dota does. The only reason I'm mentioning it is because it's the one I'm most familiar with, where they say, like, this box has a slightly higher drop rate for these sorts of items. You see what I'm saying? So they could create it like, you know, imagine, you know, you went to go buy a Pokemon booster pack, and they were like, there's these traditional ones where like everything's a fucking crapshoot, but you might get like one rare, but it'll be any rare that you want inside, yeah, this pack. Or for like $3 extra, you can buy this special one, which has a slightly higher chance of dropping a better rare, right? So it could be good, but it could even just create like more horseshit.
Yeah, I know Battlerite has two types of crates like this, except I think one of them you get by playing. Yeah, I think one of them is, yeah, you can either purchase it with real money or gold that you get from completing games and objectives, and there's others when you
say complaining about the game. It's like, that's a weird way.
and others when you complete objectives or daily quests, you just get the silver ones, which are slightly inferior. I mean, with Overwatch, the way that this works is what they do tell you is that as you're getting, as you get shitty items, it slowly increases the chance of you getting a better item. They also guarantee, like, at least one rare item per crate, but yeah, those are mostly pretty fucking disappointing. So yeah, I mean, it's definitely going to be interesting. I guess maybe companies will resist doing it because they plan to.
Do you think it's a good thing though? Like, so say they were going to implement this everywhere. Do you
think it's good?
This would. Yeah, so do I. Actually,
I think it's good because
I think we should know what it looks like, right?
Yes.
Like, you should have a realistic idea of like what stuff looks like, and by giving people like a look behind the screen, they can sort of decide for themselves, right? Like, I could absolutely see how people would say, I'm not going to spend money on this anymore now that I know what the chances are like, or even vice versa, right? Mm-hmm. Like, maybe it will, Blizzard will be like, oh shit, everyone suddenly realized how difficult it is to get this item now, we better change this.
Yeah. Although, to be fair, I mean, the thing that I was also thinking about is that irregular rewards are usually better when you want to make something addictive. So maybe if you actually know the chances of getting certain items, maybe it will counteract that and you'll be like, well, maybe I won't buy them because I'm paying $5 just for 10% chance to get like an orange super legendary rarity item or something. So, I mean, although I'm sure 10% is generous.
I still think that I see what you're saying. Like, it might be damaging, but I think that that's why there needs to be legislation, right?
Like, oh, no, I actually like this. I mean, it will damage the companies.
Well, maybe, right? Because there's ways that they can go around it. So, like, that thing that I was saying about, you know, they could sell specialty boxes, like, who knows how that might go? Like, it might be good or it might be bad. And if people stop buying the loot boxes because they have a shitty drop rate, like, the companies will definitely fix them.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Oh,
like,
yeah, no.
It's probably better that they do that if they are that shitty.
I mean,
right?
I did say like it could be bad for the companies a little bit, but I don't care because if you can give more information to your customers, I think it's always a good thing. And of course, loot boxes being a new thing, a virtual thing, they're not regulated yet. So hopefully, you know, you can bring just the right amount of regulation to.
Well, and not just that, but for, you know, weird digital economies, like I shouldn't say weird, for digital economies like they have for Dota and shit. You know, I think that it will change the value that each of these items have,
yeah,
right?
Oh,
like,
yes.
It's almost like a market for all of this digital shit. And if you know what the drop rate is, it will absolutely affect the price of
things. True. Because
maybe for better or for worse.
I remember for some crates for Dota, they only say that in every crate there's a chance that it might drop an exceedingly rare item. But what exactly does that mean? Yeah, so it would be really good to know.
Yep. No, I think it is a good idea. And who knows, like, if, you know, I as someone who never ever purchases loot boxes, like, if I knew the chance, well, I still wouldn't, but because I'm not an idiot, but like you.
So, Beard, what do you know about Super Mario Run?
I know that it is a mobile game. I assume that it is the original Mario, but you take away the movement controls, so there's just jump and that's all.
But I mean, that's accurate, except it is a unique game. It does have levels, so I mean, it's interesting because...
Well, I would hope it has levels.
Well, no, but I mean, some of those...
Procedurally generated Mario game.
Yes, no, because some of these games, yeah, they just like... It's just run forever and try to complete that bullshit objective, but no, actually there will be...
I keep forgetting how trash mobile games are.
Yeah, no, there will be... Yeah, there are levels. There's a few good ones. They're very rare, but they exist. Wayward Souls being a good iOS game, for example. But going back to Super Mario Run, there, you know, but you know, I could. Yeah, it's already like quite expensive. About, I think it's $10, if I'm not wrong. And I mean, even if there was the smallest chance that I might pick it up, to, I don't know, just maybe like on the subway. or anytime. Like, I mean, most people, you know, when they're going to work, maybe you can pop in a cool Super Mario Run level, but apparently Super Mario Run will require an internet connection to play. So if you're in
why?
This, because
why?
Because I don't know.
Because Pokemon Go. Like, what the fuck? Why? Why would you do this? Like, you're literally just cutting customers out, period. Like, that's it.
This is what I'm saying. God. This is...
Like, for what reason?
It's such a train wreck.
For no reason. Great job, Nintendo. Like, I don't understand. I really don't.
What if,
like,
you cheat and add coins while you're offline? It. I don't know, man. It's like, so dumb.
I don't get it at all. I really don't. Like, well, and it just goes to show, like, how, you know, and I know people get all fucking defensive, but, like, look, it's okay to say, like, the new Nintendo console is a good idea, but, like, Nintendo still has this really weird, and, like, I hate to, you know, do that, but, like, stereotypical Japanese video game company. Like they don't ask anyone anything. Like, just fucking talk to somebody who's released a mobile game before. Anyone. Like, how difficult would it be to just pay a consulting fee to be like, hey, is this a good idea? No, it's not. Like, don't make your game voice online. We tried it with consoles and people got pissed off. We tried it on this other thing and people got pissed off. We tried it with no mobile games and nobody plays it. Oh, better make fucking Mario. Like, it just seems like every single time Nintendo does a stupid misstep like this, and we've talked about this before, it's Nintendo doesn't listen to anybody. Okay, this is a Canada joke. It's Stephen Harper. Like, Nintendo is the Stephen Harper of video game developers. It doesn't listen to anybody, so that when it does something right, you're like, oh my god, it's a genius. They went against everyone's advice, and they happen to do something right. I can't believe it. But they fuck up, and you're like, why didn't you listen to anyone? Like, you're just deciding that you're not going to take anyone's advice and just do whatever you want. And, like, when it turns out great, you look like a genius. And when it turns out shitty, everyone's like, you're a moron.
Because at the base, putting a Mario game or Nintendo IPs on phones is a very, very good way to make money. But then it's like, it's going to be $10. Oh, good job, Nintendo. You shot yourself in the foot. Oh, you have to be online to play. Well, you just shot yourself in the lung, Nintendo. I can't wait for the headshot. It's coming. You know it will be coming.
Yeah, and $10 for a Super Mario running game is way too much. Like, is that just me? Like, I mean, just feel like that's really overpriced. I haven't seen what the product looks like, so maybe it's unfair. I'm thinking a mobile iOS game. Like, I would pay $10 for something really expansive.
It looks like the 3DS new Super Mario Brothers game with levels that seem about as well designed and on that game. The only difference is that, of course, they're made so that the game knows that you'll always be running. So, I mean, $10,
And they need internet connection to power Mario's run, apparently.
Oh, yeah, of course, because it's Robot Mario. So, I mean, it's because usually those Mario games are like $50, $60. The fact that I feel almost like Nintendo went halfway from like the usual dollar these shit games cost, you don't want necessarily to bitch about it, because if iOS had games that were more pricey but actually good, I would actually like it. The only reason why they're so cheap is that because that's the market over there. But then what they're doing is they're also making the Mario game a stupid run game, because of course there's no buttons on your phone and you can't have tactile feedback, which makes most games fucking garbage on it. So Nintendo's trying. Maybe they'll learn from this. I'm sure now Beard's already being like, Matt, you naive fool. Of course not.
Well, no, you know what, I will give Nintendo credit in that, like, look, like shit like the Wii, right? Like, I feel like the Wii was ambitious,
and it did work.
Well,
they made so much money off this and the DS. It was amazing. Then the 3DS Wii U was kind of shit.
I know, but they kept trying to fix the Wii, you know what I mean? Like, because the Wii didn't function the way... Look, I understand that it probably made its money, but I bet you it did not make as much money as Nintendo hoped it did. The Nintendo DS...
It did amazing. Okay. The Wii did fucking great.
Just just from like what I saw then, because to me it was like they released the Wii, and then like they released like that peripheral, like you remember you're supposed to like something in the end of it, and then they like they kept coming out with shit like trying to fix it, right? Like I understand that they led the charge in, you know, like Nintendo usually does, like, you know, they do the weird like peripheral shit, and then Xbox and PlayStation copy them because they like that's how they function now. They like they just copy things, like that's just what those two companies do. I will give Nintendo props for at least like being the person who's like, let's change stuff. Like, I'm okay with that. I'll take your word for it for the Wii being successful.
Oh, it did. Like both Sony and Microsoft tried to copy them, coming up with their own like
Move and the Kinect, right?
Yeah. So they were going fucking gangbusters with it. Of course, from a more hardcore perspective, it was a bit disappointing because the Wiimote wasn't as cool as we were led to believe. And of course, they tried to fix it a little bit. Then they tried the Wii U, and I guess it kind of fucked up. So now they're releasing the Switch, which is an improvement of the Wii U. I hope they can make it work.
And that's all I'm saying, right? Is that I'm not saying like I don't want to debate the marketing because like you sound confident. I don't have any evidence to contradict that. I'm just saying that like from the shit that I've seen Nintendo do, like just trying to make the motion controls like better, like with that peripheral and then the Wii U and like all this other shit. I'm sure that like the games that they release are good, but to me it's almost like they knew that there's like. Well, I mean, it's their relationship with third-party developers, right? Like, they kind of fucked themselves by not just having, like, really weird peripherals, but also, like, not being open to third-party, right? Like, they're very... Like, they really husband their property.
Oh, you know, but, I mean, if you want to say throughout... Even though the Wii U was completely successful, did Nintendo... fucked themselves with that decision throughout? Yes, they still did amazingly well.
But, right. Yeah.
No, right. For sure. So I guess next up, I guess it's a thing that Payday does. Payday 2 just adding the face of of certain presidents in the game as, I guess, President Masks. And of course now they're adding, of course, a mask for the new president. I'm going to share screen with Beard so he can just enjoy this.
I mean, yeah, I know what. Oh my god! I was gonna say I know what that horrifying face looks like, but I'm really glad you shared it with me because I didn't think it would be. Why did they make his face mostly chin?
Because
his jowl is amazing.
I got an amazing chin. I got the best chin. People praise my chin.
It's going to be huge.
So there is a new mask called the 45th, which will be unlocked for free, but you can also get the Flaming Eyes version, which is
<It's dope. laughs>
called the God Emperor Mega Mask instead of MAGA Mask, I guess. But I mean, if you want to make bank robbing great again, I guess you can get this. It's my 45th bankruptcy. I gotta get some money from that bank. I mean, I'm already vicariously playing as Donald Trump through Pokemon, through the Yungoose Pokemon. But now, you know, there's another game where you can play as Donald Trump. Will this be a new genre of games altogether? Just Trump games where you play as Trump? I can't wait. The future of America and gaming are both looking up. It's gonna be...
It is interesting to see sort of the... iconography, but you know, on this show we want to talk about not so intelligent stuff like Twitter.
Hey, it's not my fault if actually it is, but if this show is slowly devolving into more and more shit posting, but...
you know, it's still interesting. Like, I'm looking forward to the future when we look back and we're like, look at what Twitter has done, because I'm pretty confident that it's not, you know. It's really interesting, I think, to sort of look at what it's done to just society as a whole. I'm still convinced that it is horrifying, but that's just me.
Welcome to the MVB podcast, the only podcast that is a train wreck in slow motion. So moving on to another story, Crytek employees say that they're not being paid again by Owen S. Good on a rare good article from Polygon. And I guess it also says complaints recall crisis publisher faced back in 2014. So yeah, it's not the first time that they're not paying their fucking employees. And I'm going to read this article because it just makes me angry. Crytek is once again facing complaints that it isn't paying its workers. Oh, that's a beard disconnect. I know he's gonna get pissed too, so we're just gonna wait for him to call me again. Yeah, I would look at the chat, but it's not open for me. And, maybe I'll give it a quick look. Let's see. I'm gonna go to Cringe Corner very soon. Ba-ba-ba-da-ba. Oh, he's just calling me, so I guess screw that. Welcome back. So as I was reading, and I will share screens with you again, Crytek is once again facing complaints that it isn't paying its workers, with some alleging they have not seen a paycheck in more than a month. Already,
like how?
Already, this is fucking unacceptable. Especially because making a video game is not just a stupid job that anybody can do. I mean, lots of people want to do it because I guess it's very interesting, but
I don't know if I would say anyone could do it, but okay.
No, nobody can. No, I mean, I'm just saying it's interesting. Lots of people want to do it, but yeah, no, it's not just like a stupid ass factory job where you can mistreat people. These people, like, and it's just like, well, you know, we're not going to pay you for a month because I guess we're fucking retards.
I mean, even then, man, like, I've done jobs that have been like, I don't know.
Oh, yeah, that's, but you know what? Not.
I'm extremely principled. Like, if I miss one paycheck, I will just leave. Like, I won't give 2 weeks or anything. I will just leave. Like, I think if an employer disrespects you to such a degree, like, you have to put your foot down.
Oh,
otherwise,
yeah,
they will treat you like shit. Like,
true.
This is why unions started, right? Like,
yeah.
Employers can't just do whatever the fuck they want. Like, this is unacceptable to me. And we talked about this last week.
Yeah, you're right.
This is why these companies fuck with people, is because they don't stand up. Like, they should walk out. Just walk out. Like, yeah. I know that you people are afraid for your jobs. Let Crytek hire a bunch of new people who want to do it, and they won't have the same experience, hopefully.
Sometimes it's hard because...
What?
So, I mean, I was going to say sometimes it's hard because it's the only way you're making money, but you're not now, so might as well just...
But that's the thing. Like, I think that it's important everybody has this mentality.
The thing
is, some people
may be afraid that if they quit, all the money that they're overdue, they might never see it. And, of course, you can't really press legal charges because you're not the richest person ever, and this company can just drag it out. So it's probably just...
get together. Look, if it's just one person who's not being paid, that's one thing. But like, first of all, I don't know how the fuck you went for a month before shit came up. Like, to me, this is unacceptable.
Oh,
like,
yeah. No,
if an employer misses one of my paychecks, and look, if they have like a good excuse, like, hey, you know, let's just work this out, I'd be like, okay, but you're buying me lunch because I'm not going to starve to death while I'm working
on this fucking thing.
We all know. Like, these corporations are probably like big dick, like, oh no, we're not gonna, don't worry about it, don't worry about it. Like, fuck you.
Oh,
it would be
for
way
sure.
Better for you,
and,
bitch.
And yeah, I guess I was being very too nice early on because, yeah, no, if it's like, if you're not paying your, like, if you're, and to be fair, like, the article does say that, the article does say that they might be having financial problems, but even if that's the case, it is never an option on the table. Like, not paying your employees is never an option on the table. Everything else comes before that.
Well, and like, I will give kudos to the team if they're still working on it, but I think that they really should not. Right, like,
let's keep reading. The complaints have appeared on social media and have spread through Reddit, all alleging delays and irregularities in meeting payroll over the past 6 months. So that's delays, irregularities over the past 6 months. You're not getting your paycheck on time. Sometimes it can be a problem, especially if it's, you know, you have a tight budget. In some cases, workers say they currently have not been paid in more than a month, which would make me fucking bonkers.
I would just leave personally, but it's me.
A person saying he is a current full-time employee contacted Polygon to say that Crytek employees have not been paid for 2 months, and in the preceding five, pay had been regularly delayed by 2 to 4 weeks. Oh, fuck.
Like, I'm pretty sure that you people are on contract. Like, unless you guys are all somehow, like, independent contractors or something, I'm pretty sure that there's a contract. Like, that's the whole idea, right? Is that you don't have to go to, like, the huge fucking claims rigmarole. Like, you will have a contract that says Party A, which is Crytek, pledges that they will pay you regularly, right? Even if you have a verbal agreement, if you have a contract, like, you... Now, welcome to Beard's Court. I don't know what the fuck I'm talking about.
I'm just saying,
like, I've run into this shit before, and, like, I've seen people who stay on, right? Like, one person who, like, really, really fucked me in the past, and, like, I lost, like, upwards of a grand because this person just didn't pay me. It was the same thing, and, like, there were other people who were like, no, I don't want to lose my job. I don't want to go job hunting. I'm like, look.
Oh, so I guess that's... I thought it was a pause, but no, it's just Beard disconnecting again. So I guess I'll just keep reading part of this article. Polygon has reached out to a U.S.-based representative of Crytek, which is headquartered in Germany, for a statement about the allegations. In 2014, Crytek tottered at the edge of insolvency, requiring a dramatic reorganization. The sale of assets and studios and the delay of paychecks to workers... So that yearly, the Crytek CEO acknowledged that the company missed making its payroll. Crytek had done so to keep itself out of bankruptcy, he said.
You know, I'm happy that disconnect happened so that I don't embarrass myself talking about this shit anymore. Anyways, this is unacceptable, personally. Yeah.
So, yet Crytek still lopped off about 200 jobs from its workforce of 700 and unloaded both Homefront the Revolution and the UK studio, making it to Deep Silver.
The current complaints come from Crytek's main studio in Frankfurt. Salaries not arriving on time since last 6 months, with no heads up from the management nor the owners, reads one at Glassdoor, a portal for people seeking work and employers looking to hire. Every time is the last time. No apologies or explanations were offered. Yeah,
this is last time, guys. I know pay is late. I know it's hard on you guys, but it's hard on us too. So hey, this time's the last time. We swear. We know we said that last week and the week before, but this time it's true.
Yeah. Well, and again, I mean, we talked about this, but you know, if you run out of money, that sucks for you, but it's not fair to just push that down onto people lower on the ladder. I sympathize with the Crytek team. My personal opinion, I understand circumstances are tough. Like, really, we get into those situations where fuck, like, I don't even want to get into it, where, you know, you can't leave a city for whatever reason, or, like, leaving a job for whatever reason, but I don't know, to me, like, employers pretty much have two responsibilities: keep you safe and keep you fed, right? Yeah. Like, that's pretty much the responsibilities, and you carry out everything else. If they can't do that, like, they're not worth your time. Just saying.
The most recent complaint on this site, coming from a programmer in Frankfurt, is dated November 28th and alleges that money for October will not be paid until sometimes early December.
Like, how do you survive like that? are your paychecks so huge? I couldn't go, like, a month without, like, what are you doing? Like, you're just bread for, like, 1 month? Like, what?
Well,
and they're living in Frankfurt. I don't understand how they're,
you know, just
how they're alive.
A little bit of you know, you sleep at your office, you sell your house, you do some pen handling during your breaks. You can do it. Don't be lazy.
Suddenly, I don't have sympathy for programmers anymore. If only because, like, if they're getting paid enough that they cannot be paid for an entire month, I'm like,
I don't think that's what's happening, to be honest.
No, neither do I. But you know.
A message posted as an image on Imgur said that the pay crisis affects all of Crytek's studios, not just the Frankfurt HQ. Crytek has...
Yeah, nobody cares. That's me personally. Like, if a boss says, I'm not making money either, it's like, well, then you suck. Yeah, like, I'm leaving.
Yeah, Crytek has six other subsidiaries, and maybe you should sell some of those. And pay your fucking employees, you piece of shit. But hey, what do I know?
Okay. And it can only get worse for them. Like... in my opinion, the longer they wait, the worse it'll get.
This report, citing unnamed sources, said Crytek is looking to sell its Bulgarian studio, so at least they're thinking about it. Crytek Black Sea, the makers of the free-to-play MOBA Arena of Fate. Oh, it will be missed. Not really. Once known for making traditional console games sold at retail, Crytek announced plans in 2013 to transition to fully to publishing free-to-play games. I guess it's not really working that good. It recently published two virtual reality games, The Climb, pictured above, for Oculus Rift, and Robinson, The Journey, for PlayStation VR. Robinson, The Journey. Okay, so I guess they're... Yeah, I guess they're not making that much fucking money. That's... And they're not paying their employees, so yeah, that's kind of a shit thing to do. I guess talking still about terrible ideas right before we go on to the cringe corner, except if Beard wanted to tell his fucking Mary Jane's story.
Yeah, I mean, I don't really have it here. I guess. I mean, whatever. Like...
I mean, think about it. You don't have to.
Sure.
But I guess we'll just talk really quickly about an announcement. Apparently, there's this report saying that the Galaxy S8 will, like the new iPhone, not have a headphone jack. Yeah, so apparently Samsung decided to also be fucking dumb. And I guess, hey, if you have... If you're a cell phone company and you're kind of like third and you want to become first, just keep putting headphone jacks on your phone and you'll do it. You'll be fine. Just trust me.
Like, why did... Is this really such a, like... Are cords such a big problem for people? Like, I very rarely get into the situation where I'm like, these fucking cords, I'm tangled in them again.
Well, because I guess
I'm like a sea turtle getting caught in fishing net, you know, every time I put headphones on.
It has to be smaller and sleeker, and a battery, even if the battery life gets shittier every time.
Literally, we have an inhalable phone. Like, what are you doing?
It's not nanomachines. It's a nanomachine that is just a phone. It's not a robot.
Talk to me when I can inject my phone into my bloodstream.
Actually, it doesn't even work like this. It's just a phone that is so small that you can barely touch it.
And you still fucking know that when they have nanomachines, it's still going to be like you have to always be connected to the internet so you can't go for a hike in places that don't have service you'll start having like fucking heart palpitations.
Yeah, it's going to be in the future where like your organs are controlled by your phone and so you go in the subway and you like can't breathe anymore. It's like...
Well, you know that that's how it's going to be. Like, they always show the future like all this shit just like, you know, working fine. It's going to be like these dumb little hurdles that nobody thought about before. Like, you know, fast forward to that fucking Metal Gear Revengeance and that governor's like, my skin can turn metal. And then it's like, you know, it only cost me $10 to download the metal skin DLC. And fucking, I always have to be connected to the internet.
That's kind of good. Yeah, man, it's going to be like people like who can't breathe in the subway are going to be like, oh, why did they think of this? And the big like companies that make those who are now just brains in jars are like, what? You still have a use for your lungs? There you go. Yeah, so.
Just ridiculous.
Yeah. Fuck. So next up, yeah, so do you want to tell that story? So
I don't think so. Like, no. Okay. No. I'll tell it when it comes up. Like, okay. It's kind of dumb.
The only thing I'll say is he kind of explained it to me after the show last week, and he did say that, you know, before he wrote it, it was like a last-minute thing. He allegedly took the biggest spliff.
It doesn't really matter. I was just really fucked up at the time of writing, and it went over well, though.
But so yeah, it worked. Anyways, so let's go on to something more serious. We're going to switch into the cringe corner proper. Oh, yes. So this is by Game Objective by Brad Glasgow, who went over all the released information. And it was about Gamergate. So the FBI investigation into Gamergate is closed. It is now over. It is done. And let's take a quick look. So Freedom of Information Act request reveals threats, trolls abound. Also, the FBI referred to Twitter as Tweeter twice. Okay, so I guess maybe they're just bad at it. But in early November of 2014, Twitter user LiveBeef submitted a Freedom of Information Act request to the FBI concerning its investigation into the Gamergate social media movement. Now, in December of 2016, he finally received his information, which he sent to the media before posting it on Kotaku in Action, the subreddit home of Gamergate. And there is a link in the article. It reveals that the FBI began investigating Gamergate very early on and has since closed the investigation, stating, "To date, all available investigative steps failed to identify any subjects or actionable leads." So in other words, all the retards in the media saying that it was a targeted harassment campaign led by worse than ISIS terrorists are now, I mean, now it's evident, it's been proven that it's been complete fucking bullshit. And, you know, since it's been very recently released, this information, I'm sure all the video game websites and all the salons and the guardians of this world will be like,
yeah.
What?
I guess we were wrong. Mary Jane and shit like that will be like, hey, we'll be like, we're still on the fucking... Also, I'm high right now.
There you go.
One of these situations where they'll be like, yeah, we fucked up. Of course they will. They'll just be like, the FBI also misogynist.
Yeah. Could Gamergate have infiltrated the FBI? It's more likely than you think. So the heavily redacted 169-page PDF files contain some of the threatening letters sent to Utah State University, where Anita Sarkeesian attempted to hold a lecture but canceled because the public university could not ban firearms from the event after the threats. Although the threat was not, of course, it wasn't basically taken seriously by the police at the time. They're like, no, it's not. It's not a serious threat.
Right. Yeah. I remember we went over this. Basically, they said, like, yeah, don't worry about it.
The first threat.
She canceled anyways.
Yeah. The first threat is seriously written, while the second threat is an obvious troll using language commonly found in internet memes. Now, the first one, we've already read it in a previous episode, and it's just the one that says, like, oh, if Anita Sarkeesian speak, we're going to have a Montreal-style massacre, blah, blah, blah. But the second one has some interesting lines here. My name is Blank of Gamergate. It is my understanding that a lovely young woman named Blank. At this moment, we have over 9,000 bombs that we will use to blow up the TSC auditorium when Blank, you done goofed by inviting that stupid feminazi to give a lecture. You're fucking dead, kiddos. Which, again, just memes.
Good lord.
We of Gamergate, or Gamergators, as we prefer to call ourselves, are sick and tired of your stupid feminist ruining everything by saying it's sexist. You all need a hug, some tea, and maybe a gentle back massage, the monsters. And what better way to pacify you than by burning your faces off with high ordnance explosives?
Good lord.
You can try calling the FBI to come arrest me, but I'm behind 7 proxies, and you'll never be able to backtrace this IP. Also, I'm fapping to all of your pictures right now. You're hot. It's a shame you're about to get blown up. I can't believe that. Hey, if you're in the United States, some of the taxpayer money that you pay went into this. Isn't that amazing?
The subject is great. Calling all freaks and then in parentheses feminists exclamation point. Great.
Yeah. Oh, it's good. A third seriously written threat was delivered with the official in the report saying it shows the sender does not follow the news as the appearance was already canceled. So yeah, clearly some of them were just trolls trolling, and of course,
well, we know nothing has ever happened.
Yeah,
like nothing has ever happened, right?
Oh yeah, of course. But now it's like there's not even a fucking doubt. It, like the FBI look over it and they're like, no, there's nothing there. It's anyways, and you know, as far as movements goes, Gamergate is better than most of them, because anytime somebody that's vaguely affiliated or does even not affiliated but does bad thing, Gamergate would denounce it. They had a fucking anti-bully patrol on social media, for God's sake, that people just did because they didn't want they wanted to improve their image.
Right. It's sort of like, unfortunately, it's sort of like that shooter, and I can't remember. There's so many fucking shooting in the States, but that black guy who was killing like white police, and he was like, I'm affiliated with Black Lives Matter. Like, it's not fair to say like this guy is representative of Black Lives Matter because he just said like, hey, I'm gonna do this thing. It's the same thing as Gamergate, right? Like,
I would at least taking the example that you're using, I would at least expect Black Lives Matters to say, we don't approve of these of this though,
right?
Just by the way, you know, just say it. Which I mean, whatever. But I guess I'll just keep reading. The report goes on to talk of a non-specified death threat received by a reporter, which was attributed to users of the Something Awful website, which, by the way, the owner, Big Anti Gamergate, most of the website, of course, Big Anti Gamergate. Users of the website are also known as goons and are infamous for trolling. Supporters of Gamergate have often claimed that these goons acting as Gamergate supporters are the source of much of the harassment attributed to Gamergate, and apparently, there's some evidence pointing that way. So, further
not on. Just that, but I mean, like, threats on the internet are pretty regular. Like, it's not...
Oh, yeah.
Again, there's lots of, like, dumb kids, like... I don't know. I think that Joe Rogan actually put it best. Like, he said if he was 15 years old and knew that you could tweet, like, right at fucking, you know, the president, right? Like, you know that you can tweet right at Trump and just, like, call him a moron, like, if you're almost directly to him. Of course 15-year-olds are going to do
that. If you're 15 right now and you're listening to this, first, I hope you're not, but if for some reason you are, disregarding my advice, tweet right now at the president saying, I fucked your mom. because you can.
And not 15-year-olds are doing it. Like, 30-year-olds are just tweeting at him, I'm literally shaking. You know. Let's not jump too quickly.
Further on, the report details a police visit to a juvenile who admitted to making 40 to 50 threatening phone calls to one of the victims. The juvenile told me he will stop doing this and apologized for this incident. According to the police report, no further action seems to have been taken. I actually have the picture of the report because I read a few, very few pictures, but what's happening basically... In that paper, it seems to be like a friend of a person, and because that person was annoying, they would just troll her as hard as they could, which I don't think is good, because again, 40 to 50 threatening phone calls is not okay, but it seems like this person who received those phone calls from a friend thought that it was Gamergate doing it when it wasn't really the case, so that's interesting. Another event detailed an FBI visit to the home of a man whose name was involved in a threatening email. This is most likely YouTube user Mr. Repzion, because of the timing and because the documents say the man intended to post a video immediately after the FBI visit, which is likely, and they linked the video of the YouTuber in question, questioning the man using language they had previously seen in their investigation. They asked him if he had ever been referred to as a glorious winged faggot extraordinaire.
So FBI, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, imagine if the FBI is like, so we need to ask you a few questions. Have you ever been referred to online as a, and I quote, glorious winged faggot extraordinaire? It's important.
See, and the best part was like, I'm pretty sure, and this is just working from memory, like when Mr. Repzion posted that video, it was literally like somebody sent her an email that just said like, I'm going to kill you. from Mr. Repsion. Like, how is this evidence? You know what I mean?
Well,
like,
clearly this Death Star Legoon left his signature, and you know, and clearly later on he will tie her to a railroad and wait for the train to just run her over as he twirls
again,
his mustache.
It's just ridiculous. Like, if I don't know, man. Like, it's just fucking so silly that people are this terrified of other people. And look, like, I actually do get it. Like, in high school, I knew somebody who was really, really fucked up, who would, like, say weird things to people. And, like, it can make you uncomfortable. But at some point, like, you have to recognize that, you know, you can't just fucking chicken little this all the time.
Did you go to school with a gamer gator?
With a gamer gator, yeah. Obviously. No, I was going to say, did I play a victim on the internet? No, I didn't. I blew my chance. I could have been the OG victim.
Yeah, if you did, we probably would have a Patreon by now. But anyways, let's keep going. Another section discussed Intel, which was dragged into the Gamergate controversy when it pulled its ad campaign from Gamasutra as a result of Gamergate's campaign targeting advertisers on websites that published the infamous Gamers Are Over series of articles. Intel eventually realized they were involved in a controversy they didn't want to be part of, and to make amends, they donated money to diversity projects, including Anita Sarkeesian's Feminist Frequency. Still, as a result of their involvement, one of Intel's top officials was the victim of identity theft and had a bank account opened in... had a bank account opened in his or her name, with the person's social security number and date of birth. Intel informed authorities about this crime and acquired LifeLock's services for its other top officials. Okay. Further on, the report details correspondence with one of the victims of the threats, repeatedly cautioning her against taking matters to the media. And I guess that's basically the amount of the article, but it talks about a bunch of other...
Right, and I think actually that last part that you read is pretty important, where it said, like, the FBI was telling people, like, no, don't go to the media. And we can interpret that either as, like, A, you're just going to get threatened more by doing that, or B, it's not serious, right? Like, again, we pointed out the absurdity at the beginning, especially on Twitter. Like, you know, it's one thing to have something, like, mailed to your house or, like, a phone call. Like, that's pretty fucked up.
Yeah.
But, like, Twitter is a public forum. That would be like somebody on RuneScape saying, I'm gonna come to your house and kill you. Like, they could be from fucking Ukraine. Like, you have no idea who they are, where they're from. If you take that seriously, I don't know what to tell you. But again, we have people talking about being sexually assaulted on Quiver, so I don't know why the fuck I'm trying to put any sort of logic into this.
I mean, I did promise him I was going to carve his gems and give them back to him, but then I just ran away. So if the roles were reversed, I would probably come to his house and kill him. So I don't know.
True story. And my memory sort of fails, so I might not. But I can remember, like, back when RuneScape was a thing, they introduced cats. I don't know if cats are still in that, but there was something like you could keep a kitten in your inventory for a certain amount of time.
Okay.
And I remember telling somebody, like, it was my first hand at, like, oh, I'm going to tell this person that I'm going to train their cat and then give it right back to them. And I stole their cat. And then I remember I felt so bad. I did my best to, like, hunt down the person to give them the cat back, but I didn't win them. But I remember I felt very guilty for stealing someone's digital cat.
Amazing. So, yeah, what's being on screen is the part of the report that mentions the glorious wing faggot extraordinaire. And here's, I guess, just another bit that does talk about the person who called their friend like 40, 50 times. And I'm not going to read it, but it does explain that it doesn't seem to be anything even regarding Gamergate at all. So there's just that. So yeah, I guess that's basically all we had on Gamergate. So I guess, yeah, it's just this whole thing about, oh, it's a targeted harassment group. It's bullshit. It's complete. The FBI says it's complete bullshit. And I guess we're going to move on to, other sad gamer things, because there's going to be a movie. Will Ferrell will star as a pro player in esports comedy film. I can't wait. And for some reason, I want to buy Champions of Fire. I don't know what it is, but I want it. Yeah, so according to a report from The Wrap, Will Ferrell is set to star in a new comedy about professional esports. I'm already laughing.
Because professional esports have lots of, like, 50-year-old men involved.
Yeah, apparently it's part of the joke, I guess we'll see, but the entitled film will be produced by Legendary Pictures, Mosaic, and Gary Sanchez Productions. Mosaic and Gary Sanchez are producing the movie, with Patrick Connolly and John Beach of Gravity Squared co-producing. There aren't any other plot details at present, but this isn't the first time esports has been parodied in Hollywood. They're talking about another movie called Noobs, which failed. But now there's an update that says that more details have emerged. Apparently, Ferrell's performance is reportedly going to have similarities with his role in Talladega Nights, The Legend of Ricky Bobby. The script is said to reflect professional gaming of today, where professional gamers typically retire in the 20s. So maybe,
oh, I see. You're 50. You're still doing it.
Yeah. Well, I remember when I played Quake. It wasn't like this League of Losers stuff. And I guess, yeah, most interesting, Evil Geniuses and Fnatic are in discussions to participate in the film. As two of the world's largest esport franchises, they would work to ensure that the movie does not stray too far from its source material. So I guess...
Oh, yeah, okay. Like, they're either going to just be in the background and it's going to show their shirts, or it's going to be cringe as fuck. Like, no, don't do this. Whatever. I mean, I don't give a shit about what Hollywood does, but when it says they're going to, like, ask these gamers sure it's as close to the source material, like, don't bullshit me.
It's going to be...
How stupid do you think I am?
It's going to be, how do you do, fellow kids, the movie. It's really going to be... It's going to be great. I can't wait. Oh my god, it's going to be another train wreck. I guess this is the theme this week, train wreck.
Like Bart says, let me guess, they'll be living in the basement and no girls allowed jokes. Yeah, I'm not going to take that bet. Like, I bet you there absolutely will be a no girls allowed joke.
Well, and then he's going to be like surfing the internet. Gamergate, what's that? Sounds horrible. Oh my god, you know what? I just found what will save this movie. The bad guy is Acid Rain.
bringing laser pointers to the League of Legends tournament.
I can't believe it. Yeah, he's in a wheelchair since he got shot by Ice Cube or whoever the hell shot him, and now he's like, I have come to take my revenge. This time I will not kill you in real life, but in the game, which is the same.
It's exactly the same. That's why.
It's exactly the same.
I can use a sword and use magic. Anyways, let's talk about something else.
Yeah, let's move. I guess we're going to talk about... Oh, I forgot to add a few pictures, actually. Just give me a few seconds. It's going to be real quick.
So it's one of these things where, like, I don't know, we'll see how it goes. Like Bart says, they sort of already did it with Pixels. And again, it's fantastic when somebody like Will Ferrell, they say, like, it's going to be based on Talladega Nights, so it becomes like a Adam Sandler / Jim Carrey thing, where it's like they do this one funny thing, and you know, you just see it enough times, it'll be funny again, I promise.
Yep. All right. Finally, I fixed the thing. So, you know, Times released their top 100 thing that they, I guess, they do at the end of the year. And they had the top 100 fictional characters of 2016. Can you guess what is the top fictional character of 2016? Of course it is. Pepe.
What the fuck?
The frog.
Why?
The most...
What?
So I'm just going to read it. I guess I'll just put it a little bit bigger here on the screen if we want to read it. So, Pepe the Frog, the fringe comic character, created by artist Matt Fury in 2005, was already a popular internet meme, but this year Pepe became ubiquitous as the mascot of the alt-right movement, which used him in racist, profane social media posts. In September, the Anti-Defamation League officially declared Pepe a hate symbol.
What the fuck? Man...
So let's
Matt must just be fucking so furious. Like, how is this okay?
So I don't know. It's just dumb. Again, this whole year is a train wreck that just never ends. I don't know exactly how interesting all of these are, but let's just go to at least through those that are in the pictures.
No, I don't think we should. Like, already, it just looks so dumb.
Okay, yeah, well, of course, they have, I guess I'll just say, like, number two is Barbie, number three, I can't see it, but number four is Barb from Stranger Things, which, like, she was a very minor character, and I don't know why...
I don't know. Like, that's why I'm saying, like, don't fucking waste your time reading this. And then Harley Quinn. Like, this is literally Times is like, you know how we can be more successful? Be like BuzzFeed.
Oh, God.
Like, this is a BuzzFeed top 100 fictional characters.
It's true.
Just telling you. Because there's, and then next to Barb, Pokemon.
Yeah.
What the fuck are you talking about? Like, I understand Pokemon Go. Aha, I get it. Pokemon Go. Pokemon's popular again. Ha ha ha.
Well, okay, so I need your expertise when it comes to Game of Thrones, because I know I don't watch Game of Thrones yet. I really do want to, but...
Oh, God, I just read Hillary Clinton.
Yep, Daenerys Targaryen.
The fucking apex of powerful female, right?
Yes.
You know...
No, just the beard. Let me read it. Don't spoil it. Let me read it. As she charged towards Westeros, the oppressed but resilient star of Game of Thrones, played by Emilia Clarke, felt like a heroine worth rooting for, and her revolutionary style of destroying the patriarchy drew comparisons to a real-life would-be ruler, Hillary Clinton. You said it was BuzzFeed.
Yeah, so does that mean fucking George R.R. Martin should go back and rewrite that part where, spoiler alert, like, she takes over a kingdom and instead she can just get her head cut off by some guy and he's like, it's huge. how is Hillary? Never mind. I don't fucking understand this at all.
It's so dumb. It's like, can you...
It's BuzzFeed, dude. Everything is BuzzFeed now. Hooray! We live in BuzzFeed world. Yay! Right.
So let's go back to...
Pokemon is my favorite Pikachu. Yeah, very...
How do you do, fellow kids? So yeah, now we're going to go back to this tweet. I don't know if you remember, from Adam Ellis, who complained that... Have the designers of this game ever met a woman? Now, I'm going to give you more details as to who he is, because after all, he does have a check mark on Twitter, so that means he must be somebody important. Well, that's the joke, Beard. Just don't freak out on me. Now, he writes a comic series, like a daily webcomic for BuzzFeed, of course. Now, let's take a look at one of them where he talks about Westworld. Huh. Wait, what's that? That female character has breasts like these. Adam, have you ever met a real woman, you piece of shit? And I guess at the same time, we'll just take a quick look at the comic book. The panel where he says...
I know, but Matt, you're missing the point. Like, because the women have their breasts out and there's fucking in every episode and you see boobs and dicks and people having sex in every episode is actually... just supposed to point out the absurdity of our current culture and that everybody watches shows with boobs and sex in it all the time.
So here's what he would do. By the way, all these characters suffer from abuse syndrome, and they all have the same face. But he says, if I went to Westworld, and you can see him holding a little bunny, and I found him in the desert. His name is Clarence, and we're best friends. So I guess that's what he would do. He would just go find bunnies. Why don't you just do it in real life, buddy? Just buy an actual bunny. Because I guess the appeal of Westworld is you do things you wouldn't do in real life. Maybe not like as some of the show implies, which is like full on psychopath. But just have fun adventures. Also, is that a robot bunny or is that a real bunny? I don't know. I don't watch Westworld. I don't know the lore. But let's move on to Jonathan McIntosh.
It is just funny that the show clearly uses like sex to get people to watch the show, including SJWs, but they don't understand the hypocrisy because they say like, no, it's a commentary on sex, therefore it's okay that I get aroused when I watch this show.
Although, okay, if any writer that is not them does a commentary on something, it's not actually a commentary, it's what they truly think.
Well, no, it's quite literally that, like, if you are intelligent enough to not bash someone over the head with your ideology, so you, like, use imagery in a way where you don't come out and explain to these fucking morons, like, because that's what Westworld is. Like, every fucking time, like, somebody comes out from the side and they're like, by the way, do you understand we're using sex to sort of comment on sex? It's like, yeah, no, I didn't fucking understand that. Thanks for explaining that to me.
I mean, I put it later.
I wouldn't have been able to follow.
I put it later in the show, but I might as well.
It's just funny that this is what SJWs are doing now.
I might as well show it now because I got you on a Westworld rant. Let's just go. I'm going to show this here. So this is a BuzzFeed article that says the biggest mystery on Westworld is where the hell are all the queer people?
all over the place. I don't know what they're talking about.
Where the hell are they? There's none.
In the show? Like, I don't know what they're talking
about. Look at all
like,
those.
The first episode, a girl kisses another girl, and a guy fucks a girl and a man. It shows him having sex with another man and a woman, so I don't know what they're talking about.
Now, I think this BuzzFeed...
lots of...
Yeah, this BuzzFeed article was written by a blind person, I think. That's why they're like, where the hell... They're actually just asking, where are they? I can't see them because I'm blind.
Literally.
I'm not implying that there's not queer people.
Where all the black people, and I was going to be like, what are you talking about? What I found really funny... never mind. It'll be a spoiler.
Okay, so...
A black character dies and, like, their replacement for their job is another black person. And I was like, is this supposed to be, like... I don't understand what you're doing. Like, you're trying to say that all this person in this profession has to be black? Or, like, is this your attempt to do, like, what's that called when you have to hire people of different races? The word escapes this moment.
Me too. What a surprise. A word escapes both hosts on the MVB podcast. Take a shot. I can't. Can't even. Anyways, let's just move on to the next thing. So next up, we have a good old Jonathan McIntosh. So Ian Miles Chong posted his argument where basically he says, you can always count on a man to criticize women's clothing. Strange how you never hear anyone criticize the way Gladiolus dresses, which is this chap who you can see his abs. He's only wearing an open leather jacket. And yeah.
Right.
And here's Jonathan McIntosh's explanation, so hopefully you will go to bed smarter tonight. One is designed as a sexual fantasy for straight men to desire. The other is designed as a power fantasy for straight men to identify with. So there you go. It's a power fantasy.
Yeah, yep. I definitely fantasize about being that guy.
Yeah, Gladiolus with all those abs. I mean, it's not like, I mean, you know, if you look at all those romance novels where the men are depicted as like, they have
ripped,
like long blonde hair and they're incredibly ripped. It's just like in case a man wants to read it, they can identify as this badass dude. See, all along, it was just, you know, it was once again just a ploy. Even females book are not safe from patriarchy. It's so horrible. And you know,
like, I don't understand, like, then what are women or like gay people supposed to identify with? Oh right, being the most weird person, right? That's all they power fantasize about,
is
being the most unique.
Yeah, and then Final Fantasy is a game full of toxic masculinity. Just look at this line from the
like
game.
This. Like, this is really good.
Where he says, every moment, I'm desperate to earn my place, to prove that I'm good enough, and you can choose. Do you want to tease him? Do you want to comfort him? Do you want to chastise him? Or do you want to send him to bed?
So, Matt, hyper-masculine.
Yes. Yeah. So toxic.
Definitely chose the wrong target.
Masculinity, where men never showed their emotions because, you know, that's just how society wants you to be. Speaking of gay moments, no, just kidding. Just kidding. We're going to move on to another game. Just have this. That's not the right thing. I'm just going to just find it really quickly. There you go. So there was this Waypoint article with the title, "I hope The Last of Us 2 is super gay." Well, I, as a gamer, hope that it's just a good game. I'm going to be happy if it's a good game. Does that sound...
I think it's more important to push an ideology.
You know what? That's true. I was completely
it's
wrong.
It's more important that video games are made as a statement than made entertaining.
Of course. So...
Look, we have enough games as white men. We have enough games catering to us. I think from 2017 onward, like, no more games for white people. We've had enough.
We had so many games.
Slavery. You remember that time, Matt, when you and I had slaves? You remember that?
Of course.
Yeah, of course. Me too.
I mean, to be fair,
and we were kings of every single country. You remember that when only white people owned the entire earth and nothing else.
Yeah, I mean, to be fair though, if they would ban white people from buying video games, maybe I could finally dig into my backlog a little bit. It'd be good. It'd be a good thing. Because I have so much game privilege that my backlog is full of games.
Am I not allowed to play as the black girl in Dead by Daylight?
No.
I've never asked this question, but I'm not allowed to?
No. I know you've been doing it.
Because I'm controlling her, right?
Like, yeah.
It's,
I mean, right. I was a bit...
I should ask Jonathan McIntosh, can you do that for me? I don't have Twitter anymore.
I mean, because I wanted to say something, but then I was like, if you weren't playing as her, the whole team of survivors would be white. Racist. So I'm like... I don't know. It's a gray area. I'm not sure, but
never mind.
So Danielle Riendo released this little article here that she posts here on Twitter. Here's my review of the latest Mario and Sonic is Live, wherein I discuss the context of Russia's anti-gay laws and Birdo.
Okay.
You know, so this is how you know that the person who wrote this article...
That's how you review games now.
No. This is how you know that their first choice of job was not to write about video games. So they tried to...
No, it is. Like, that's what's depressing, is that I think it is, like... Jesus, and you caught me on the wrong week. Because I'm fucking reading Gulag Archipelago, and it's just really, like, got in my head. And there's a whole chapter where, like, he talks about ideology and, like, why it is the most evil thing.
Explain what the book is for the viewers, just quickly.
Sure. So if anybody doesn't know, and I highly recommend it so far, I'm not done. I just purchased it, but... Matt sent me that YouTube video of Joe Rogan's interview with Jordan Peterson, that U of T professor who was like talking about SJWs. Basically, like, Canadian law is going to start saying that, which I didn't recognize anyway. I'm fucking rambling.
Just what the book is.
If you don't use pronouns, then it's against the law. And he recommended Gulag Archipelago, which is just about the Russian gulag and like how fucked up it was. Beard obviously was fucked up. Yeah, but this talks about like specifically what happened, and it's a fantastic piece of literature. But you know, it's shit like this where it's quite literally just like the way that you get people to purchase or like click, and you know, we feed into it to a certain degree as well, right? Like the way that you get people to look at your articles now, no matter what the fuck it's about, is by talking about like, oh, it's meaning on current culture, like, oh, we better like refine that, which is quite literally like what they started to do in Soviet Russia, is like take every single piece of media and talk about how this affects your culture as a whole. Like, it's just one step away from being like, you can't publish anything that doesn't have a commentary that we agree with, which is where we're going.
I can't wait. Are you hyped?
Oh, I'm super excited.
You know, when the internet will be this heavily regulated place where you can't download any game that could be seen as wrong think, you'll be glad that you have this huge backlog of games to play. See, I haven't been... I'm a gaming prepper, you see. I'm not just lazy into completing my games. I've been game prepping this whole time. So let's just move on.
Like Bart saying, which I completely agree with, I think that people have this fantasy where an editor invites them and says, I read your Pokemon review. Your commentary on residual tensions in Germany was brilliant. Like, yeah, that's it. But it's not even just that, unfortunately.
I need you in my prestigious magazine.
Like, because of the shitty echo chamber, people think that this is how you communicate now. And again, like I explained, like I went on a Twitter date, like of all the fucking examples too, or actually it wasn't, I said Twitter, I meant Tinder, and it actually wasn't. It was a fucking
Twitter
plenty
date.
Of fish
that
date,
sounds
where,
great.
Where that's all this girl would talk about. Like that's how some people communicate in those circles. Like they think that, if you have an opinion on, for example, like, what were we talking about? Like, again, like, just everything turned into this argument about, like, capitalism versus communism. And it's like, can we just have dinner and, like, talk about stupid shit? Like, why does it have to turn into, like, I have to examine, like, where you consider yourself to be? And my favorite is, like, when
steak,
you know, they
steak,
like, I'm going to go on
beard.
A date with you, but I hate
beard.
Men. What are you talking about?
This,
yeah, go ahead.
This steak bleeding reminds me of the proletariat. Can we just eat?
Oh, it was something like, she didn't understand. Like, we went to a bar where, like, we were drinking beer and eating fries, and she was like, I don't think capitalism works. And I'm like, I don't understand how you can sit here with a straight face. Like, we met on Plenty of Fish and we're at a bar and you think that communism would do this better. Like, I don't understand. I don't understand. Like, I'm very lost. Like, why you think that this is something that could happen. Yeah. Anyways.
So let's read the only part of this article that actually talks about this, because most of it is an actual review of the game. It was actually boring, so I didn't bother reading all of it, but I did find this little paragraph here, which is titled, No Russian. The most surreal experience in a game full of bizarre sights, such as Bowser pirouetting to classical music, was playing the game, a game of hockey against a team of rainbow-hued Birdo characters in the context of a modern Olympic competition in Russia. This event is intentionally staged as part of Legends Showdown mode, so it piqued my curiosity. The real-life 2014 Sochi Olympics have been contested given Russia's new anti-gay laws, which severely limit freedom of expression for LGBT people and have essentially outlawed public displays of non-heterosexual orientation. Playing against a team of rainbow, possibly transgender, as Birdo was labeled as such on their first appearance in Super Mario Bros. 2. And that's actually a real thing. But anyways, characters, it felt wildly subversive in a game that otherwise appears so apolitical. So there you, that was actually the developer making a statement there.
Yeah. No, and my favorite part is it seems like they're trying to say that, like, they wish that the game had stayed non-political because there were rainbow-colored Birdos playing hockey.
How subversive!
How subversive. How
subversive. It's my favorite new buzzword of the year, I think. How subversive. I think I'll start saying that in...
It's very problematic.
In random conversations. And hey, finally, last article of...
Let's talk about your favorite anime.
So this is titled, Anime's Fan Service Can Be a Minefield on Kotaku by Cecilia D'Anastasio. No, it's just kind of like a follow-up to it where she's like, when I talked about Kaijo and people talked back, I got butthurt, but...
I received death threats.
No. No, but whatever. I mean, we can read a little bit of it. I thought it was a bit interesting, but I don't know. Let's just see how it goes. Today, how you feel about panty shots can determine how you feel about anime as a whole. Oh my god. Hey, don't question it. And it's not just panty shots. In the blockbuster anime Food Wars, women's clothes burst off of their bodies when they taste an exquisite bite of steak. I'd like to point out that I haven't watched that series, but I've heard that men's clothes explode off their bodies too. Although this article won't mention it, I wonder why. Skirts don't often don't cover the bottom half of women's butts in prison school, which is
not that never happens in real life.
Yeah, and I'd like to
never
say
never ever.
Breasts are regularly the first body part to enter a shot in Is It Wrong to Try to Pick Up Girls in a Dungeon? Which, by the way, I've seen this one and I didn't notice, so either it's not as obvious as it would first seem, or I'm gay, one of two.
That's the point, Matt. It's buried into your subconscious. You probably normally talk to women that way and you just didn't notice anything different.
Of course. In the West, the practice of lacing gratuitous sexuality, and especially female sexuality, into anime is known as fan service. Love it or hate it, anime studios have made a conscious effort to feature fan service in most of this year's Western subbed anime titles. Well, there's still plenty which don't have any of that.
Yeah, I was going to say, you know, like the smash hit of Is It Wrong to Pick Up Girls in a Dungeon?
Like, I mean, it was definitely one of the... Yeah, it was definitely one of the good ones, but, like, you have much better animes,
I know, but
like...
Nobody fucking knows about this, Matt. Like, with all due respect...
Yes, they do.
Okay.
Beard, please. Yeah, I gotta keep at least this. No, but... anime fans will, but, yeah, most people... Like, even the biggest animes, like JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, doesn't have
Ask
any of this.
Ask me in an hour what Is It Wrong to Pick Up Girls in a Dungeon is, and I will have forgotten.
That's probably true. It's not mainstream stuff. It's not mainstream stuff. It's just stuff that that people that regularly watch animes will know about. But you know, still, I'm just thinking, like, in the sphere of animes, it is probably one that most people would recognize. Unfortunately for some Western anime fans, panty shots and their ilk can be a major turnoff. It is, and to be fair, like, even for me, like, when it's clearly too obvious, I'm just like, oh, okay, now, you know, it's...
Coming from the guy who likes Kill la Kill, just, you know, just putting it all out there.
But you don't understand, the way they do it in Kill la Kill, it's so subversive.
The clothes that, you know, no, these super revealing clothes are what make her powerful.
Yeah,
oh,
it's subversive.
I see.
No, but there's some...
That's why I will never buy a truck again, is because Sailor Moon is clearly supposed to be, like, you know, she rips her clothes off and she's underage every time. So car manufacturers are clearly misogynists
subversive.
And rapists. Subversive.
Yeah. I was going to say, because you kind of interrupted me, but I was going to say when it's too fan service-y, and sometimes it is, but sometimes it's just like, you know, whatever, it doesn't bother me. It's not something that where I'm going to be like, oh, fuck this. Anyways, it can be a major turnoff. It's distracting from the story, they say, and breaks immersion. For feminists, fan service can fall into a media trope that portrays women specifically so they'll appeal to viewers attracted to women, and not as flawed whole people. I mean, they could be both, but too complicated. They say it's objectifying trash. But avoiding fan service is easier said than done. The truth is that it's ubiquitous. Even smart, artful shows like Flip Flappers or Monogatari are riddled with it.
Definitely. You know, like Spirited Away, definitely exploited, definitely objectified people. Yeah. Psychopaths, definitely, I can't
of
believe.
JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, it's full of titties, except not.
Let's even go like more, you know, probably the biggest anime in like a while. Attack on Titan, definitely filled with objectification in that show.
And again,
Dragon Ball Z,
Sword Art Online, it's not.
Yeah.
It seems, it's almost as if this article is looking at reality through a certain lens to try to deform our perspective, but I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. Or they think that they're arguing with someone, but it's like, this isn't, you know... It's that shitty thing of, like, debate class where they're like, you're supposed to win the debate by any means necessary. Yeah, don't do that in a journalism article or you just look like an idiot. Like, you are just purposely being ignorant.
Yeah, so I'm going to read the. I'm going to skip ahead a little bit, but here's another sentence. Penty shots are childish and distracting, they argue, even as others who like it say it's a fun part of the culture of anime. What to make of it? How should a progressive anime viewer think about fan service? Let's do a fun game where I'm going to replace the word progressive with something else. Here I go. How should a religious anime viewer think about fan service? I don't know. I'm just, maybe it's a religion what you're doing, but I don't know. Maybe you don't care about it, or if either don't watch it or just watch it and don't care about it so much. I don't know. Fuck. I don't. there's another.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, I just want to skip. Yeah, they talk about rail wars here. They say, when somebody like. Yeah, I'm just going to read this. Channing Kennedy, an anime fan and director of the San Francisco Zine Fest, recently shared some concern about fan service, saying, "I hate being complicit in something that I view as a serious social problem." And there you go. That's privilege, ladies and gentlemen. Seeing tits and ass in anime, serious social problem. We got to do something about it. What are you talking about, people starving to death? The reduction of women, especially young women, into objects of desire without agency. Well, I mean, if I want to be pedantic, I could say that they're just fake characters that don't exist, so they actually don't have agency, but whatever. He recalled watching the first episode of Rail Wars, an anime about aspiring rail conductors at a...
What the... Anime's so fucking weird.
At a specialized high school. Yeah, see, that's what I'm thinking.
What? Kind of like plot. I thought that the food show was weird. Like, and even the butt fighting thing, like, that's weird, but I get it. What the hell could happen in a rail thing?
I mean, that's the kind of like the, say what you wish of anime, but it seemed to have this magical power of being able to adapt anything into an anime. And it, I mean, I don't know if it works, but yeah, so.
Well, you know, not to be like that, though, and see, this is sort of my fault because I don't have, like, that much of a knowledge about it, but it's sort of like my wife, like, you know, I didn't realize that there were animes out there that are just, like, the soap opera stuff, but anime. Like, there's just soap operas, but are anime instead. I was not aware of that. I assume that that's...
Yeah, some of them are just cute girls doing cute things, and...
Yeah. So,
if you watch it, you want to fucking stab yourself in the eye, but hey, it's still...
See, that's the thing, though. Like, I feel like this whole thing... Well, I don't know about, like, the objectifying panty shots or whatever. I don't know what they're talking about. And, like, I don't really know what, what sort of demographic...
I just want to read. So anyways, when he saw the presumed female love interest's entire vagina pressing through her underwear when she searched a train compartment, he closed the browser tab and he said, cursed, that he couldn't even watch teens striving to be rail conductors without being slapped across the face with tits and ass. And then between parentheses, a YouTube video montage of Rail Wars, a fan service describes it as a reason to pick up the show. And it's just... It's not even a video of, like, a known anime critic. It's just a video with 6,000 views with random pictures from Rail Wars. And they say, hey, look, there's tits and ass. Good reason to pick up the show in the description. So,
right. So anyone could have made it. It could have been.
Yeah, it's like good cherry picked example there. But yeah. So.
But I mean, with that being said, though, I do think they have some grounds. Like. Why, like, who's supposed to watch this show? Like, it's marketed toward, okay, it's a show about
trains.
It's clearly supposed to be a romance show where high schoolers want to be train conductors, but you also see a vagina, presumably. I'm very confused as to who this is marketed towards. Maybe it's just me, but I think they have a little bit of grounds insofar as, like, what the fuck? Like the food fight thing, I haven't seen the show, but from the stuff that I've seen where, like, people's clothes explode, it's supposed to almost be, like, a joke. Like, the whole thing is, like, you eat food that... And it's always put in comical terms. Like, half the time you see, like, cherubs with the character's face flying around them, like, oh, this is the most amazing rice I've ever eaten. I'm allowed to say that I'm married to a Chinese girl. Like it's you know, it's something like really ridiculous like that. So it's not something that people are supposed to.
Are you saying you already appropriated your wife's culture, Beard? Is that what I'm hearing?
Exactly. Yeah. No, I mean
it's that fast.
You heard us. You heard us on the show. you know, it's something where like I think it does have to be taken into context. And sort of like what you said, like, I don't think it's that big of a deal, but, like, the fan service shit, yeah, it can be a little stupid. But, I mean, Hollywood gets shit for it, too. Like, I fucking hate when characters just fall in love on a movie for no reason. Like, just recently, we're watching one. Fuck. What was it? Anyway, it doesn't matter. I was watching a movie just recently, like... Oh, that fucking new Harry Potter movie. That's what it was. Like, literally, the love interest talks to the main character. Like, no joke. Talks to him for maybe, like, 20 minutes. Like, not even throughout the runtime. And more than half of that time, spoiler alert, is her hating him. Like, arresting him and telling him that he's doing a bad thing. And then, at the end, she's, like, crying when he leaves. It's like... What are you doing? Like, why did you fall in love with him? I've literally seen you together on screen for maybe 5 minutes. Yeah. Like, it's shit like that I'm like, this is stupid. I wouldn't say that it's objectifying, though. It's just stupid writing. And I'm sure that anime does the same thing. But
oh, yeah. Like, there's, like, talking about Kaijo, which, again, the whole joke of the show is that it's kind of like a shonen slash sports anime, but they replaced every technique with butts, and somehow they all have superpowers for some, but they're not really superpowers like in superhero things. It's just like they have their own unique techniques. We're like, yeah, whatever. I'm just gonna say, like, since I reviewed the show, there's somebody did a judo flip, but since they can't use their arm, they use their hardened nipple to flip somebody over their head, and that was the funniest fucking thing. But there's some small scenes where really the only reason why something's happening is fan service, and those parts, because they're not funny, they're just, I mean, for me, they make me cringe a little, but, you know, as long as it's
when you're not jerking off.
No, of course not. There's even one where
Quick has a really good point, like, where they say Japanese humor is pretty different, though.
Yeah.
Like, you're absolutely right. They almost treat, you know, like the West, we can have a show or we can have a game called Dick Jousting or whatever, where dicks enter asses and nobody complains.
I mean, people did, to be fair, but yeah, I see what you mean.
Did they?
Well, it's banned from Twitch, I think.
Yeah, but I understand why. That's nudity. I just mean, like, people didn't say, like, oh, you're objectifying penises.
Oh, yeah,
like,
yeah, that's no, for sure. Yeah.
There's no SJW thing. If it was about vaginas, they would, you know, we'd have Jonathan McIntosh on here sobbing, being like, I can't believe they literally took a vagina and made it part of a game.
Big, like, big hungry vagina coming April 2017.
Yeah, anyways.
Where it's a vagina that just eats many things of various shapes. I want to see this now. God, okay. Going back to I don't know. I don't know if I want to read the rest of this article. They just go back to basically complaining about, like, oh, Kaijo and that stuff. If you want to read the whole article, maybe I've missed something, but I mean, do tell me on Twitter and all those other social medias and stuff. And hey, if you like the show, hate the show, leave us a comment, tell us if you like it or not, and give it a thumbs up. But and only a thumbs up. And I guess, I mean, I'm kind of like ending the show because I think we're about at the end. Is there anything that I missed that you wanted to tell our dear, dear, amazing audience?
No, I don't think so. So we have another show now for those of you who might join us. For anyone who's interested in D&D, we do a podcast called the Dumpstat Podcast on Tuesday night. Is it Tuesday for you?
Yes, it is.
At the same time, if you want to come check it out, we're going to be talking about making travel interesting this week, along with other things. If you know, want to listen to the show live, you can join us at this channel. I think that's it.
Yeah, you can also, of course, just research on iTunes MVB Podcast to get all this content on the go if you happen to watch it after the fact and all that kind of stuff. So hey, once again, thank you very much for listening. Thank you very much for speaking in the chat. It really does improve the show, because sometimes, and it really encourages to keep on doing this kind of cool stuff. And yeah, you can share it around and do all that kind of stuff. And yeah, I hope you have a great week. You fucks.
See you next week.